okay, so you've got your drum set. This is your first drum set. You've got it home. You want to set it up and you want to start playing. Where do you start? Well, it's a real good idea to start from the bottom and work your way up. Always set up the drums on some kind of a carpeted surface. Otherwise, you're really going to be in trouble when you start playing with your feet. You will slide forward and the bass drum is going to be in the next room before you know it. So get the carpet, and what is a real good idea is to start with just the bass drum with the pedal attached, the hi-hat with its stand, the snare drum in its stand, and the throne. Now sitting down, because everybody's basic construction is a little bit different, you're going to maybe sit a little higher or a little lower than your friends who play drums. So you're going to have to find out what feels good for you. Nobody can quite tell you how high to sit or whatever, but this is mostly where you're going to really do all of your work, with the left foot here, the right foot over there, and the snare drum in the middle. Now you can have a set that has 1,000 tom-toms and 1,000,000 cymbals, but this is really the core, the heart of everything that you're going to do. So this has got to feel relaxed, effortless. You can't be thinking, is my foot going to be here? Is my right foot over here? You really have to just have this kind of center of gravity. With the snare drum directly in front of you, what you're going to want to find is a point that's right about at waist height. Okay? It's not really a good idea to play with the snare drum too high because your wrist and your hand are going to be like this. You're going to almost be reaching up to play. And on the other side, you're not going to want to start playing with it below your waist because you're really not going to have any power. You're actually going to waste motion going down to get to the drum. So I like it about at waist height. So you get a feel for all these sitting down, and it's got to be relaxed. Try to sit upright. Next step would be to add the tom-toms and the floor tom. Now with the rack toms, I personally like the rack toms to be a little higher than the snare and at an angle so I can get a good crack at them. Make sure that the two toms are close enough, but not so close that you're going to hit the rims. The floor tom is going to be at basically the same height as the snare drum, okay, but just a little bit off to the right so you're not going to start bumping it with your right leg once you start to go playing with the bass drum, okay. Now here's a great exercise for just the snare and the tom-toms, basically getting accustomed to getting around the set and seeing how close everything should be. You don't want to have to reach too far for anything, okay, that's a real waste of motion. So this beginning thing will be right, left on the snare, right, left on the first tom, right, left on the second tom, and right, left on the floor tom. And I'll do that slow. This is a clockwise type motion around the drums. One, two, three, four. You get that going a little bit. Make it consistent. Let's do it a little faster. One, two, three, four. Everything is easy to reach. I'm not reaching out here. I don't have drums way over in the next room. You can do that counterclockwise as well. Start off with the floor tom and go around this way. Okay, effortless. Shouldn't even have to think about it after a while. You should be able to look this way and play, hit the drum and know exactly where it is. The next step would be to add the cymbals. With the cymbals, here's the crash cymbals, and that should be at a good range that you can get a good strike at it. And the ride cymbals should also be in an area that you can play it for a long period of time without having to reach real far for it. I see guys, they put it 1,000,000 miles away and their arm is out like this. It should be real easy to all night if you have to, okay? Just make sure with the cymbals, no matter how you set them up, that getting them close is one thing, but getting them too close, you're going to hit the cymbals inadvertently. You're going to go around the toms and whoa, you're going to smack a cymbal without really wanting to. So be careful of doing that. Once you've got a setup that works for you, it's a great idea to mark the stands, especially of the cymbals and of the tom-toms, so when you break down your drum set and you go to a friend's house or you go to rehearsal with a band and you have to reset up your drums, you don't have to start from scratch again. Just take 5 minutes, take like a felt tip marker or a piece of tape and put it around the stand. So when you fold them up and you reset them up, you got the same height the same angle that you had at your house. This prevents a lot of frustration. You don't have to start from scratch, and you feel much more comfortable. A really good thing too would be to maybe mark on tape where the positioning of your stands as far as your bass drum and your hi-hat goes on the carpet itself. So that way you can immediately get that set up. Now I'd like to talk a little bit about tuning the drums. Tuning the drums is a real individual thing, and unlike a lot of other instruments, the drums really have a lot of leeway as far as your interpretation of where the tone and the pitch is going to be. There's two things that come into factor here. What kind of sound do you want, and what kind of response do you want from the drum heads? A real loose tuning is going to provide a kind of soggy atmosphere to play on. You're not going to get too much of a roll happening on a drum that's real flappy, which is why a lot of guys tune tight, so you can have a good response. So no matter what pitch that you're trying to get, we're trying to get each one of these drums to sound good by itself and within a set so that they sound good as a unit. Let's take a look at the construction of a drum before we go any further. You've got the shell itself, okay? And what you have here is lugs. These lugs hold the screw. The screw, in turn, holds the drum rim in place, and that holds the drum head. And what we need to do to tension or tune the drum head is use a drum key. And what you do is you basically turn it clockwise to tighten it or to sharpen the pitch, counterclockwise to flatten or loosen the pitch, okay? And the object here, no matter what system you use, you're trying to get each one of these lug or screw areas to be in tune with each other, okay? You want this, the sound, to be the same as that one, so tapping around each one of them. There's two different tuning methods that I can show you right now. One of them is cross-tensioning, in which, say, you start at this screw right here, and you tune that. You tune the screw that's right across from it, and then you start on this one and go across the drum. So you're constantly going across in this kind of a fashion and getting them all to agree. That's one way. The other way would be like a clockwise motion, where you start at 12 o'clock with this screw, and you go to the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and the next one. Tuning the drums and getting a good sound involves a lot of playing around. Okay, there's not enough time to really get involved with as much technique as involved with this. However, to say that this really separates what you're going to sound like from the next guy, from the next guy. The sound of the drums, the way you hear the tone, what kind of heads you use, if you use muffling. Now, I don't use any muffling on these drums, maybe just a little strip on the snare drum and some muffling inside the bass drum, because today we're miking up the bass and I don't want too much overtone when you put that mic in front of there. So there's a little hole cut in from the bass drum. But that's about it. I want the drums to ring out, especially in a high volume situation where I'm really banging. It makes no sense to put pillows and a lot of tape all over these drums. Hey, it sounds great where you're sitting, but you go 25, 30 feet away, and it absolutely sounds like you're hitting a paper bag. There's really no sustain. So don't be afraid of the sound of the drums. I know a lot of young drummers are afraid of the drums. Learn to tune the drums so they sound good and let the sound carry. That's really going to project. You won't have to hit as hard to really be heard. Here's some ideas about holding the drumsticks. There's basically two methods for holding the drumsticks. One would be the matched grip, and that's what I usually use, in which both hands hold the sticks the same exact way, the right and left, okay, as opposed to the traditional grip, where the left hand basically holds the sticks sideways. And this was real popular at the turn of the century with a lot of rudimental drummers who had the snare drum on the side and had to turn the left hand to be able to play the snare drum. A lot of jazz drummers use this too. This is the most popular grip though with rock players because the hands are a little more balanced, it's a little more natural to get around the set, and you can play a little louder with the left hand when you need to. So what I want to start off with is just making a stroke and holding the stick using this grip. What I do is I try to find the balance point of the stick. And that's generally about 4.5 to 5 inches from the butt end, okay? You can see that. And what you want to do, you want to find the balance point. You don't want to hold the stick too far down or too far up. There's kind of an area right in here where the stick feels like it pivots real well. It's like a fulcrum. So what you do is the first knuckle on this index finger, right to the side of that first knuckle, and the flat part of your thumb, you're going to create the grip right there. And what you're going to want to do is you're going to hold it in such a way that it's loose and yet firm. You don't want to over-tighten and close this space, okay? You do not want to close this space. You want to leave that open, and with the remaining three fingers now, you just kind of curl them around the backside of the stick, because these are great for manipulating the sticks with finger control and things that will come later on as your drumming will evolve. So you want to kind of get them used to the fact that they're going to be there. Okay, once again, not tight. Don't grip the sticks. Absolutely unnecessary to have a death grip, what I call, especially when you go to play loud. This is one of the most difficult things for a drummer to learn, is a really relaxed yet controlled way of holding the sticks. And I'm going to show you a couple things to think about as you're developing some kind of a technique on the drums. First of all, I'll talk about making just a full stroke, what I call it. You start with the tip right about here, and what you do is you just do that. Okay? This is one motion rather than and bringing the stick up. Okay, that's two motions. What I'm doing is I'm accepting the rebound. All drumming, basically, and when you see somebody who plays real fast on the drums, the reason it looks effortless is because they're not fighting the natural rebound of the stick. The stick will always be faster than your hand. Just take a stick and throw it on the ground and see how much faster it's going to come up. It's kind of like the analogy of playing basketball. When you're dribbling a basketball, you're thinking more about the initial throwdown than you are about bringing the ball up. You don't have to bring the ball up. It's going to come up by itself. The speed that it's going to come up, it will be determined by how much velocity you throw down into it. So if you get a kind of a lazy throw down, it's going to come up like that. If you give it a hard throw down, it's going to come up. So you're accepting the rebound, always playing off the drum. Here's your first roll. This is going to be the single stroke roll. Start it with your right hand. If you're a left-hander, start it with the left. And it's basically one stroke for each hand. Now, there's a few things I want you to keep in mind as you're doing this. I want it to be in time. I want the height of the sticks to be even. And I want the stroke to basically be consistent, okay? Let's start it off at a nice, slow tempo. 1, 2, 3, 4. Right. Left, right, left. You're not worrying about speed. Speed is not the issue. That's going to come later when you got control over it. A little faster. 1, 2, 3, 4. You double timed it. Okay, don't worry about the speed. The second roll is going to be the double stroke roll. And that's two strokes for each hand. Starting with the right again, right, right, left, left, right, right, left, left. The trick here is to make each stroke the same volume-wise. A lot of times what people do when they start to play doubles, especially faster, is that second stroke starts to sound wimpy. Practice it loud, practice it open, and practice it with the same amount of intensity on each stroke. If you play it a little faster, a little faster, okay, practice that. Here's a combination rudiment which uses singles and doubles. It's a single, a single, a double, a single, a single, a double. It's a paradiddle. And the sticking is right, left, right, right, left, right, left, left. A little faster. Now you may want to even make one of those notes a little louder. The first note, you might want to make what's called an accent. Okay, this is what that's going to sound like. Okay, that one note is just a little louder than the other three notes. So practice these things for warming your hands up and for control. Okay, these are things that are great to practice on a practice pad so that you don't go deaf, that you don't disturb your parents or the neighbors, and practice these things with a metronome. If you have a metronome, turn it on, practice these things. They're great for developing the hands. We're ready to start playing our first beat at the set. Now, the first thing I want you to do while you're sitting at your drums is to start counting. This is a great thing, and all drummers have to do this, regardless of being able to read or being able to play real complex things. You must have a foundation in counting out loud. After all, when you kick a band off, it's really up to you to have the tempo and to be able to give the time to the band so we know when to start. And that begins by practicing in the kind of fashion where you can count out loud. So let's start doing that. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Make it consistent. Start to feel that whether you're counting or not. Now the first thing I want you to do while you're counting is to start hitting the snare drum on just beats 2 and 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay? Make it sound like a groove. Okay? Now, when we got that feeling good, and there's no doubt, let's start adding the bass drum on beats 1 and 3 to the 2 and 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3. Great. You got that. Let's add the hi-hat on what I'm going to call quarter notes. That's going to be a hi-hat stroke on each beat. It's going to be like this, just by itself. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, this is going to involve crossing the right hand over the left hand. Okay, so you basically do that. Let's do everything now together. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. All drumming consists of basically unison and non-unison parts. No matter how complex the beat is, it can really be broken down into either notes that are together, like this, and notes that are together, like that, or notes that are opposite. This would be an opposite. Okay, this would be together. Okay, that's in its most simplest way that you could boil it down. So now what we want to do with the right hand is start to play eighth notes. Eighth notes are 2 evenly spaced notes for each beat, counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. We're going to now have 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Let's add the rest of the set. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1. You can play the bass drum on all 4 beats. This is called 4 on the floor. 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, nothing dazzling, but your friends will love it if you can keep just a simple groove like that happening for a long period of time. There's a few ways to play the snare drum. One would be to hit the drum exactly in the center with just the tip. And that's what I've been doing so far. It's like this. In the center of the drum is really where you're going to get the most amount of tone. On any of these drums, the center is really where you're going to get the fattest sound. There's another kind of a sound that you can get out of the snare drum, and that's called a rim shot, where you hit the tip basically in the center and this and the shaft part of the stick on the rim at the same time. Okay, it's like that's going to cut through a loud band. And as a rocker, you really have to perfect the art of the rim shot, because that's really a separate sound unto itself. There's a third kind of sound in which you take the stick and you reverse it now. You have the tip down here and you got the bunt end up here. This is great for ballads or like the slow blues and stuff like that. It's called a cross stick. You put your palm down on the drum like this flat. And depending on where you move your hand, you get different pitches. You know, you hear like on a ballad or something like that where you hear. It's a completely different sound. I want to talk a minute about the bass drum technique. There's a couple of different ways that I play the bass drum. One of them is a flat foot, okay, where most of your foot is on the pedal board at all times. And basically you start, just like with the drumstick, where you start from this position and you go down and you hit. The same is for the bass drum. You start from this position and you make your stroke. Okay? It's basically a motion using a lot of your ankle and just your foot turning in. Another way to play the bass drum that's real effective in rock and roll is to play what I call